Don't know much about history. Don't know much biology. Don't know much about a science book. Don't know much about the French I took. But I do know that I love you. And I know that if you love me too, what a wonderful world this would be. Don't know much about geography. Don't know much trigonometry. Don't know much about algebra. Don't know what a sliding rule is for. But I do know what it one is two. And if this one could be with you, what a wonderful world this would be. Now I don't claim to be an A student, but I'm trying to be. For maybe by being an A student, baby, I can win your love for me. Don't know much about history. Don't know much biology. Don't know much about a science book. Don't know much about the French I took. But I do know that I love you. And I know that if you love me too, what a wonderful world this would be. La ta 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 ta.
History.
Well, la ta 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 ta.
French I took.
Yeah. But I do know that
I love you.
And I know that
if you love me too, what a wonderful world this would be.
Sing and dance, and it don't walk. Long as I can have you here with me, I'd much rather be forever in blue jeans. Honey's sweet, but it ain't nothing next to baby's treat. And if you pardon me, I'd like to say we'd do okay forever in blue jeans. Baby, tonight, baby, tonight, by the fire, all alone, you and I. Nothing around but the sound of my heart and your sigh. You here with me.
You're just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off of you. You'd be like heaven to touch. I wanna hold you so much. At long last, love has arrived, and I thank God I'm alive. You're just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off of you. Pardon the way that I stare. There's nothing else to compare. The sight of you leaves me weak. There are no words left to speak. But if you feel like I feel, please let me know that it's real. You're just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off of you. Just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off of you.
Trust in me when I say, oh, pretty baby, and it's easy. You'll think it strange when I try to explain how I feel, that I still need your love after all that I've done. You won't believe me. All you will see is a girl you once knew, although she's dressed up to the nines. At sixes and sevens with you, I had to let it happen. I had to change. Couldn't stay. Looking out of the window, staying out of the sun. So I chose freedom, running around, trying everything new, but nothing impressed me at all. I never expected it to. Don't cry for me, Argentina. The truth is, I never left you. All through my wild days, my mad existence, I kept my promise. Don't keep your distance. And as for fortune, and as for fame, I never invited them in. Though it seemed to the world they were all time. I love you and hope you love me. Don't cry for me, Argentina. Don't keep your distance. Have I said too much? There's nothing more I can think of to say to you. But all you have to do is look at me to know that every word is true.
I am the resurrection, and I am the life. He who believes in me die, yet shall live. He who believes in me shall die. Fast love of the Lord ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed. Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe God, believe also in me. I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all the creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. If we live, so then whether we live or whether we die with the Lord, for this end Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing to this world, and we could take them out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath of the everlasting arms. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. He believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. With faith in Jesus Christ, we receive the body of our brother, Arthur, for burial.
Our brother was washed and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore with confidence pray to God, our Heavenly Father, the giver of life, that he will raise him to perfection in the company of the saints. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day our brother Arthur, and we thank you for giving him to us, his family and friends, to know and to love as companion in our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Please be seated. We're going to have some words of remembrance by Graham, Brigitte, and Taylor.
Hello, hello.
Good afternoon, everyone. I normally would, as people know, probably just wing it, but there were a bit too many things to put down to say about my dad. Thanks for coming to help us celebrate Dad's life. Dad was so many different things to so many different people. Family was his number one priority, and by family, I mean his immediate family, but also all the good friends who have become family, and the people who knew him through work and sport over the years, and also those from overseas who also thank you for coming today. Dad grew up in the country and was the only son of Jack and Ivy Bethell. By all accounts, he was most certainly spoiled rotten by his parents and sisters. One of these stories that we have heard several times was that everybody had dressed up and had gone to a wedding. And a gentleman came up to Jack to comment on his beautiful daughters, to which Grandad replies, "Yes, they might be beautiful, but you have not seen me son." We've always heard the story of a country boy meeting a town girl. Dad was quite in demand as a young man from all accounts that we have been told. However, on his 21st birthday, he seemed to take a shine to a certain young lady. His birthday cake, if you can believe, was made in the form of a cricket pitch. And his famous line to Mum was, "Would you like to come and bowl a ball on my wicket?" The rest is history, as they say, and Mum and Dad were married for 59 years and produced Neil, Brigitte, and me. Mum and Dad had an amazing life together. My childhood memories take me back to Mum taking us to school with a pretty worthless group in the carpooling that went on in those days, going to Kensington after school while Mum and Dad seemed to play cricket or hockey nearly every day of the week, except Sundays, and going to the beach at Perongiap. And also, I had the joy of going to various cricket grounds with Dad, sort of between the ages of 7 and 10, when he was playing first division cricket. Touring teams, sports gatherings, parties with friends are too numerous to mention, but to say a good time was had would be an understatement. Dad always wanted, though, to get back to the country from living in Perone. And unbeknown to us, he put in a bid for Stronghold Plantation and was successful, because we found out he was successful when one evening we took a drive and we drove up the long driveway with the cabbage palm trees, and he said, "Folks, this will be our new home from next week." We, to say the least, we were not very impressed, because we were used to the South Coast, the beach, getting everywhere very easily, and now we were going into the middle of nowhere. Bridge, Neil, and me had an incredible childhood. We wanted for nothing, but were never spoiled. Dad's calm demeanor was equaled by his wrath when it came out. We all had the opportunity to go overseas to study when we got older, and we loved and we laughed. Thank you, Dad. Dad's professional life speaks for itself. He started at Barbados Mutual, worked his way up through the company, and eventually became chairman of Sagicor. By all accounts, when I was certainly going and meeting Dad at Sagicor after school, his nickname was the Ayatollah. And all of those who knew the Ayatollah knew what I mean. But no one could believe that the person that they socialized with on weekends was the same man that turned up for work on Monday mornings. G and I had the incredible opportunity 2 years ago when we were in St. Kitts watching Jacob play cricket, when we witnessed firsthand the respect that colleagues had for him. People heard that Dad was at cricket, and I was amazed at how many people actually just came to say hello and to speak to Dad. We learned about his reputation throughout the islands at that game. Sport was such a big part of Dad's life, like everything else. He excelled at it through hard work and determination. He played hard, but he always played fair. He was 100% committed to it and never let it interfere with his work commitments. Again, we've heard a lot of stories, or I've heard a lot of stories over the last few years from Dad. A couple of them that spring to mind with me is that Dad would play cricket for Barbados and would go to work in the morning and then go to the ground warm-up and play against Jamaica or Trinidad. Somehow I don't think that would happen these days. He also told me a story of when he was playing for Barbados. The team was traveling overseas, and he obviously knew or had a feeling that he was not going to be selected in the final 11. So he just went and had a quiet word with the manager and said, "Listen, You're not going to pick me. I would rather stay here and go to work. And that's exactly what he did. Dad was totally committed to Pickwick Cricket Club. I remember there were days when Dad would leave home, 6 o'clock, go and pick up an old Land Rover, get down to Kensington, cut and roll the entire outfield and have it looking the best, only to lose the toss and have to field the whole day. Dad became president of the club and obviously served in many different forms. Bridge, obviously, as we know, became president afterwards. Dad also loved his golf. And as we know, Dad also was someone who didn't tolerate much dishonesty in golf. I always remember a story he gave me when he was playing partner. They'd finished the hole, and Dad said, and what did you have? He said, a five. He said, are you sure? He said, no, six. He says, are you still sure? Anyway, the final score was a 9. Dad likes his sport, but he also liked sport. And Mr. Bino from next door would understand what I'm meaning by when he liked sport. And there's nothing that gave him greater pleasure than playing pranks on his buddy next door. Those who might not know, one Christmas hamper at the Barbados Golf Club, my father actually drove a car into the pro shop with phone calls from management saying, who drove the car in? Well, it was Arthur Bethell. But that's impossible. Could not be Arthur Bethell. He did. Every now and again, he would do something, and we were always totally surprised because it was so out of character. Dad was not an extravagant man, but boy, did he love a deal. If there was a sale on anywhere, I'd get a call. Graham, there's a sale on at Massey TV. It's $500. I said, Dad, I don't need a TV. He said, but no, you need to buy one because you never know when you might need one. You know, he would travel. When he traveled with all that time with Sagicor, I cannot remember the times that Dad actually traveled first class. He would travel in economy, and when they got to the hotel, him and Mr. Marshall would share a room. He never believed in buying a new car. However, when it came to any cost that was an issue for family or friends, that was a different story. There was never any doubt that he was there for everyone. That leads me to another love of his life, the horses. Dad owned many horses with his good friend Edward Gill and enjoyed nothing more than looking after the horses and placing his bets. Unfortunately, after Edward's death, he lost a bit of interest, but that has sort of been rekindled recently by Mike, Laura's husband, his new son-in-law, who has a very keen interest in horses. So much so that he's actually Uncle Fred Bethell's racing colors. He had them at home, and he had them at home for probably 25 years, have now been passed on to Mike. And Mike is now racing horses in England under Fred Bethell's colours. He'd love the bookies in England. We would be going to a cricket match and we would be late. We'd all be nervous. And Dad would have to stop to go any bookies, place that bet, make sure he could see what was happening. And it just was I think over the years, he probably might be just about even. Kindness and charity were another one of Dad's incredible attributes. I don't think we will ever know truly the extent to which he helped people over the years. He always put everyone before himself and continued to be the patriarch to us all until the very end. There were many, many loans. I remember going up and Dad would have a book and he'd say, well, Paul still owes me $2,400. I know because I still owe him probably $1,650,446. He would never let us pay for anything. Up to 2 weeks ago, we bought dinner, went up and had a little something, Mum and Dad. He wanted to pay for it. Almost offended when I said, Dad, it's only $100. No, I have to pay half of it. That was just how Dad was. Susuma Roo, the beach house, was another area that he loved. Family, friends. You know, 1959 was when he got involved. He had to find $250 was his quarter share. And we still have it now, some 64 years later, and we will continue to enjoy it as well. Back to family. Since Dad's retirement, Dad has thrown himself fully into family, which keeps him very busy. We still have a lot of issues going on. He's helped us thoroughly with anything and everything. Business, insurances, taxes, recycling, returning, trimming trees, having old suitcases mended, anything. Dad was the one. If we told him no, he was most offended. Dad, however, had his own health challenges over the years. Dad, I don't know if anybody, Dad had a severe heart attack when he was 35. He had cancer in the early 90s, a hip replacement, heart surgery, and most recently, a cataract surgery. But he never let it slow him down. He also never stopped working when he had cancer. And we know for a fact that he had a craving for rum cocktails. And on leaving work, he would pass by the yacht club most evenings and get a shaker to take home with him. He said it used to settle his stomach beautifully, apparently. Dad was also another one that loved to call people. Every night he would sit in the patio, call family and friends. If he didn't manage to reach you right away, you would get a message from him. Wait, you left the island? You know, you don't know where Locos Hall is? I can send you a pin drop. And that was how Dad was. He also started to know how to use WhatsApp to keep in touch with all the grandchildren. His cryptic messages have been the source of much laughter amongst the grandchildren over the last few days. His grandchildren were his absolute pride and joy. He had so much pleasure watching them grow up. Those grandchildren being Laura and Taylor, the lawyers. Ben, the farmer or agricultural contractor, as he tells us. Haley, the doctor. Jacob, the professional cricketer. And Rebecca, working on her psychology degree. It is not only their chosen professions or their accomplishments that Dad was so pleased about, but it was the way they went about working hard, being kind to people, that has made him most proud. Dad also had the privilege of watching two of his granddaughters get married recently, and he has welcomed his two son-in-laws, Mike and Joe, into the family with his typical love and humor. Dad only had three children, but he's managed to attend five weddings. He has loved and supported us all, and regardless of the circumstances, wanted peace and love within the family always. One of the reasons I came back to Barbados in 1997 was the fact that I was concerned that Mum and Dad were getting older. They were 57. And I wanted to spend more time with them. I can honestly say that we've had 26 amazing years, of which I'm so grateful. I've received so many incredible messages from people all over the world, recounting stories about Dad that have meant so much. My reply to all of these messages has been standard. He was a great dad, my best friend, and we will all miss him dearly. Dad really was my best friend. He was the best man at my wedding. He's been by my side in the good times and the tough times. We have laughed together and we have cried together. And that I can say is thank you for everything, Dad, until we meet again. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Having the last name Laurayne means that my lineage is often a mystery to most people when I meet them for the first time. As a result, I am usually confronted with the familiar Bajan introductory questions of who are your parents and where do you come from? And depending on how much time I have, I would usually save a few minutes by jumping straight to, I am Arthur Bethell's granddaughter. An identifying phrase that I have always been immensely proud to proclaim, and one that is guaranteed to spark a light in almost any Caribbean person's eyes. Whether they knew Grandad as the avid sportsman, the prudent CEO, the gracious host, or the good Samaritan, what's evident from all the messages and calls that we've received the last few days is that everyone agreed. He was a great man. Because he knew so many people and touched so many lives, he had a contact for just about anyone or anything you could ever need. Grandad had a person for secondhand tiles, fish in Oystens, eggs in St. George, chicken in Christchurch, for placing a bet on a horse in just about any jurisdiction. I have been driving with Grandad in St. John when he recognized his breadfruit contact playing dominoes on the side of the road. Grandad pulled over and said, "Skipper, any today?" And the man dropped his dominoes and headed directly into the tree above him, returning with the most beautiful breadfruit. Grandad even had a person at Shula's restaurant in Dadeland, Miami, that he swore would still remember his order even though he hadn't been there for about 9 years. These people put down their dominoes or answered their phones when Grandad called, not because he held big roles at big companies or clubs, which he did, but because he made meaningful connections with and a lasting impact on everyone he met, from the smallest to the biggest. He attributed this and most of his successes, both personally and professionally, to the simple act of listening. His advice to me when I started working was to remember that if you are too busy speaking, you will not hear what the people and the world around you are saying. In fact, the reading that he chose for today's service, which Laura will read in a minute, and which I found in his files, scribbled on a small page out of a mutual letterhead notebook, echoes this perfectly. Grandad lived his life that way. He listened, and he chose all his words carefully. And the result was that when Grandad spoke, everyone paid attention. Rightfully so, because everything he said was either solemnly important or wonderfully hilarious. He had a story for everything, to Grand's dismay, and you knew it was a good one when he started to cry from laughing before he got past the first sentence. That same laugh often also snuck out when he was teasing Grand, and nothing brought him more joy than to say something that he knew would rile her up, like that he was going to get another turkey for Christmas this year, or that they had visitors on Wednesday when he knew it was really Tuesday, wink at one of his grandchildren and wait for Grand to say, "Dad, are you really trying to annoy me?" Then would come his giggles that turned into hysterics. And if you turn to the inside fold, the back of your hymn sheets, you'll see the perfect illustration of this exchange, which was an everyday occurrence in Locus Hall. He loved Gran so much, and he loved his family so much. He shed a little tear every time we would all be together. It would be very quiet. You wouldn't know he did it until somebody looked and said, "Granddad's crying again." Like Uncle Graham mentioned, he mastered WhatsApp so that he could keep in touch with his grandchildren around the world. And he would send messages at all hours and on all topics, wanting to know what there was to report. He would message Jacob with batting tips, Doc, Haley, updating her on Grand's various appointments, Laura and Mike wanting insider trading tips for racing, Ben to see how the ladies were treating him, Beck for updates on her budding soccer career, and Joe and I to make sure we got home safe, or to tell me to call Grand. He always signed them off, "Love, GD," or "Grandad." While we've all heard stories of the stern and serious Grandad, known by some as the Ayatollah, that's not the Arthur plane that his grandchildren knew. Our Grandad was a jokester with the sweetest heart and a temperament as soft as his hair. All of us here are so lucky that every time we said goodbye, he walked us all the way out and waved to us from the wrought iron gate until our car was out of sight. I know that he's doing that today. And the six of us are especially lucky that we got to have him as our granddad. Chin chin, granddad.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming. As I look around and see so many different people who knew my dad from many different aspects of his life, I want to share with you just a couple quick stories which show a bit of the lighter side of Dad that always make me smile when I think of them. About 25 years ago, Dad had cancer and he underwent chemo. And he seldom missed a day of work during all of this, but he did take a little bit of holiday time. And when he was due to return to work, his hair had fallen out, and he was very concerned about returning to the office with a bald head. He was worried about his colleagues feeling sorry for him. So he asked me if I had any earrings that he could borrow to wear to work, because he thought that they'd be so shocked at seeing him in earrings, it would distract them from the bald head. So I lent Dad a very fetching pair of green, dangly, clip-on earrings, and off he went. Dad was a Pickwick man for life, and was president of the club when it was still located at Kensington. Pickwick were having a karaoke evening, and as I was also on the committee of management, we went together to support the event. At the top of the stairs to the entrance to the clubhouse was a gate, and as we entered, someone closed the gate behind us, and they said, "You're not allowed to leave until you sing a song." Well, a couple hours later, Dad said to me, "Bridge, ready to go." I said, "Well, Dad, we haven't sung a song yet." He said, "Well, we're going to do a duet." So next thing I heard our names being called out, and I said, "But Dad, we haven't picked a song." He said, "No, I have it sorted." He had selected his favorite song, "Don't Cry For Me, Argentina," which is possibly the hardest song in the world to sing. So there we were, tone deaf me, and the man with the softest voice in the world, trying to sing "Don't Cry For Me, Argentina." Well, I don't think we got through the first verse before the man at the gate went, "Stop, y'all could leave now." It was really very bad. As Graham mentioned, Dad loved a good practical joke, and Robin Bino was definitely the brunt of most of them. And Dad would go to great lengths with these jokes. And Robin had, or has, a very tall pine tree in the front of his garden. And Dad was forever telling Robin, "Robin, that tree is too tall. It's gonna fall down and mash at the house and everything." And Robin would say, "Arth, the tree is fine." Anyway, Dad decided it was time to do something. He somehow managed to get a letterhead for the Civil Aviation Department of Barbados. And he came to me and composed a letter to Mr. Bino, citing regulations from the Civil Aviation Act that stated that any structure over a certain height had to have a flashing beacon on the top. He went on to say that if this, it had been drawn to their attention that Mr. Bino had such a structure, and if he did not rectify the situation within a certain time period, further action would be taken. Dad then got another friend to sign the letter so that Robin couldn't recognize his signature, and he had my husband Ian drive up by the airport to post it so it would not have a St. George postmark on it. Well, Dad was like a child at Christmas waiting for Santa to come as he kept looking out for the postman delivering the mail. And finally, a few days later, Robin called. "Arthur, I just got this letter. I don't know what you think I should do." So Dad started to tell him, well, I don't know, Rob, we might look at putting a beacon up on the top. But Dad couldn't last for long, and his voice cracked and he started to laugh. And the light bulb went off for Robin. Well, I believe a few expletives were said. But Dad thought that was the best joke in the world. And any time he told that story to anybody, he would stand there and his shoulders would start to go, and he would laugh until the tears poured down his eyes. He was very proud of that one. The last thing I'd like to share is something a good friend said to me last week. She said, Bridge, as a daughter, it is unbelievably hard to lose the first man you've ever loved. And that he was and will always be the first love of my life. I love you, Dad. Thank you.
We now stand and sing the hymn, All Things Bright and Beautiful. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Almighty God, we remember before you today your servant Arthur. We pray that having opened to him the gates of larger life, you receive him more and more into your joyful service. With all who have served in the past, he may share an eternal victory of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Be seated for the first Bible reading.
A reading from a letter of James, chapter 1, verses 19 to 20 and 26. Understand this, my dear brothers and sisters. You must all be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. Human anger does not produce the righteousness God desires. If you claim to be religious, but don't control your tongue, you are fooling yourself, and your religion is worthless.
We will stand and sing the Crimond version of Psalm 23, "The Lord is my shepherd." Be seated for the second lesson.
The reading is taken from John chapter 14, verses 1 to 6. Do not let your hearts be troubled. believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going? Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.
The song now, Let There Be Peace on Earth. Please stand. Speak in the name of God, who is Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Let me first of all, on behalf of the parish family here at Christ Church Parish Church, offer to the family of Arthur our deepest condolences as you mourn the loss, but as has been emphasized thus far, we give thanks for a life well lived, a life which has touched many, many persons. And you're here to support the family, yes, during their period of mourning, but also, to, as I said, to join them in thanking God for a very, very special person. We have with us here at Christchurch the Dean of St. Michael's Cathedral, Dean Jeffrey Gibson, and therefore also on his behalf, I offer condolences. I especially want to offer my condolences to June, Arthur's wife, and in the fairly brief time we had together preparing for this funeral service, I really like her. And she emphasized something which I want to follow through on her wishes, that during my message, I will not refer to the deceased as Arthur, but I remember him as Dad. And I want us to think about that in terms of Dad and in terms of relationships. Dad and in terms of relationships. Now, we have a number of years. We have the calendar year. And the calendar year, of course, is from January. We're getting ready to observe and to celebrate that. During the midst of that calendar year, we will have a financial year, usually from April to April. We also have the academic year, usually around September, October, depending. And we also have another year, which I wanted to think about based upon my text for today. And that year is the church's year. And it is the church's year, and it begins on Sunday, and that year is Advent. And Advent tells us that Christ is near. In fact, there's a little song, a little hymn, it's not been selected, but these are the words. Advent tells us Christ is near. Christmas tells us God is here. In Epiphany we trace God who manifests his grace. Those three Sundays before Lent will prepare us to repent. Those three Sundays before Lent will prepare us to repent, that in Lent we may begin earnestly to turn from sin. Holy Week and Easter then tells who died and rose again. Oh, that happy Easter day. Christ is risen indeed, we say, and it goes on. But it makes a point in terms of Advent. Advent, of course, comes to the word that means to come, that we are waiting for the coming of Jesus Christ. But we note during the period of Advent that Jesus can come to us in a number of ways. He can come to us, as of course we will emphasize at Christmas, as a babe at Bethlehem. We also recognize he can come in his earthly ministry, teaching and preaching, healing the sick, being there for people, reaching out to the least, the last, and the lost. And also he will come ultimately again, as we think about in Advent, as the conquering king, the one who will judge the living and the dead. Advent tells us Christ is near. And therefore we are encouraged during the season of Advent to bear in mind that we always need to be prepared and we need to be ready. But how can we be prepared and be ready when, as even the scriptures of himself state, that God can come in different ways? How can we be ready? How can we be prepared? Well, I think we can be ready and prepared by recognizing that while, yes, that God can come in different ways, he always comes in love. When he came as a babe, he came as love. When he came to teach us about who God is in terms of the parables, etc., in his earthly ministry, again, it's in love. And when he will come again, it will be love to bring home to himself the one he died for. He always comes to us in love. And that's why when I believe he sends persons into our lives, he gives persons to us in our lives, he offers persons in our lives who can teach us what love means, it cues us and makes us aware so that when God can come, we can be ready, we can be prepared. Now usually, and I've been a priest many, many years, especially when it comes to mothers, persons emphasize, you know, how they will feel about their mother. And even in the, again, a hymn, can a woman's tender care cease towards the child she bear? Yet forgetful she may be, yet will I remember thee. Again, based upon the text. But it also talks about a mother's love and emphasizes, of course, that many persons could identify that love, and indeed this family for June. But the main point, I think, and mere fact, that the dad could be referred to as dad, makes the point that there are sometimes the persons who come into our lives who can really show us love, who are the male aspects of our family. And not always persons who have been involved in our birth process, but they have come into our lives, maybe as someone to be looked up to, someone that could be able to give us a joke, someone to see us through, someone to give us some advice to see us through some difficult times. And even though we may not literally always call them dad, they are a father figure to us. And I believe in this instance, for today, as you gather here, you're giving thanks for someone who was given to us, I believe, by God, to reflect that particular aspect and that reality. And therefore, through his life, through his witness, to show the reality of love. Now, June mentioned to me, not only did he have a love for his family, but he had a love for the same God. The love for the same God in terms of praying for his family, recognizing, I believe, And that's why even the hymn writer could say, can a woman's tender care cease to ward the child she bear, yet forgetful she may be. There comes a time when even a mother's love, a father's love, a brother's love, a spouse's love, it can only be there for a particular time. And we have, of course, the reality of separation. We have the reality of death. And therefore, when someone prays for you, or when some person reads in the scriptures what love is about, and apparently that was a type of individual, the dad, reflected to his wife and other members of his family, that indeed is a true, true gift. And it's a true, true gift, not only that he can recognize that he will not always be here with us physically, but he can give us the one who will always be with us. And therefore, that can help us in our mourning. And that can also enhance and make truly a sense of thanksgiving. That even though dad was gone for a period of time, the one that he loved is there to look after you and to guide you and to support you. To be there for June and other members of your family. And also to be invited to prepare yourselves to receive that same love in your day-to-day life. And that's why as we entered into this service, we said, yes, some things that were said and sung, but I want you to think about what was said, again, about love. And it comes from St. Paul. And Paul can write, I'm sure, I'm convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things come present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, as reflected by that, as reflected to you through Jesus Christ, who is coming. Amen. Let's now stand. And if it is our faith, the words of the Apostles' Creed, I believe in God, now sing a hymn during which an offering will be taken for the Salvation Army in Dad's memory and to the glory of God. By the hymn of the Republic, mine eyes have seen the glory.
Thank you. Let us pray. We pray for those who mourn. We commemorate Arthur. Let us pray with confidence to God our Father, who raised our Lord Jesus from the dead for the salvation of all. Grant, Lord, that your servant may know the fullness of life which you have promised to those who love you. Lord, in your mercy, be close to those who mourn. Increase their faith in your undying love. Lord, in your mercy. May we be strengthened in our faith. Live the rest of our lives in the fellowship with your Son, and be ready when you call us to the fullness of life. Lord, in your mercy. Show your mercy to the dying, strengthen them with hope, and fill them with the peace and joy of your presence. Lord, in your mercy. We commend all people to your unfailing love, that in them your will may be fulfilled. And we rejoice at the faithful witness of your saints in every age, praying that we may share with them in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to you our brother Arthur, who was reborn by water and the Spirit in holy baptism. Grant that his death may recall to us your victory over death, and be an occasion for us to renew our trust in your Father's love. Give us, we pray, the faith to follow where you have led the way, and where you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit to the ages of ages. Amen.
We now have the Nunc Dimittis. Feel no guilt in laughter. He knows how much you care. Feel no sorrow in a smile that he is not here to share. You cannot grieve forever. He would not want you to. He'd hope that you would carry on the way you always do. So talk about the good times and the way you showed you care. The days you spent together, all the happiness you shared. The memories surround you, a word someone may say, will suddenly recapture time, an hour, a day, that brings him back as clearly as though he's still here, and fills you with the feeling that he's always near. If you keep those moments, you will never be apart, and he will live forever locked safely within your heart. Thank you.
Don't know much about history. Don't know much biology. Don't know much about a science book. Don't know much about the French I took. But I do know that I love you. And I know that if you love me too,
what a wonderful world this would be.
Don't know much about geography. Don't know much trigonometry. Don't know much about algebra. Don't know what a slide rule is for. But I do know
what it one is two.
And if this one could be with you,
what a wonderful world this would be.
Now I don't claim to be an A student, but I'm trying to be. For maybe by being an A student, baby, I can win your love for me. Don't know much about
history.
Don't know much biology. Don't know much about a science book. Don't know much about the French I took. But I do know that
I love you.
And I know that
if you love me too, what a wonderful world this would be.
La ta 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 ta.
History. Biology.
Well, la ta 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 ta.
Science book. French I took.
Yeah. But I do know that
I love you.
And I know that
if you love me too, what a wonderful world this would be.
You're just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off of you. You'd be like heaven to touch. I wanna hold you so much. At long last, love has arrived, and I thank God I'm alive. You're just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off of you. Pardon the way that I stare. There's nothing else to compare. The sight of you leaves me weak. There are no words left to speak. But if you feel like I feel, please let me know that it's real. You're just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off of you. Just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off of you.